is presented in partnership with British Cycling, and we're going to be going through sports nutrition for coaches. And it's also going to be very related to athletes as well. So whether or not you're an athlete or you're a coach, you should get a lot of great information out of this. So just a couple of things before I turn it over to the guys. We are going to collect questions and have them at the end. So we're putting aside a couple minutes for questions and answers with Nigel and Andy. Please don't wait until the end to enter your questions, because we are frantically going to be putting them all together and trying to come up with a good order of how we're going to ask the questions. We're also going to be recording this, so if you can't listen to the entirety of the webinar, or if you want to go back and listen to it again, you will have that ability. So with that, I'm going to go ahead and hand it over to Andy Kirkland, who is the Coaching and Education Officer over at British Cycling.
Thanks, Melissa, and welcome to everyone around the world. Now, I'm delighted that we're now on our third webinar in partnership with TrainingPeaks. And this evening, we've got one of the top sports nutritionists in the world, and I'm delighted to introduce Nigel Mitchell of the Great Britain Cycling Team and of Team Sky. Now, my earliest memory of Nigel was at the World Championships in Fort William, the Mountain Bike Championships in Scotland several years ago. And not only is Nigel a great nutritionist, he's a great cook as well, and he made one of the best curries I've ever tasted in my life. Nigel has got experience from grassroots up to the very highest level of sport, and we're very, very lucky to have him present tonight. So without further ado, I'll pass over to Nigel.
Thanks very much, Andy, and thanks very much, Melissa. And you know, if people out there, if you're going to be in Barnsley in Yorkshire sometime and you're looking for a cup of coffee and maybe a curry, then give me a shout. So, yeah, my name's Nigel Mitchell. I'm Head of Nutrition for the Great British Cycling Team, which I also work alongside with Team Sky as well as the Head of Nutrition. So this is really combining the Great Britain Olympic side with working at the top end in professional cycling as well. So at the moment I'm down in Belgium for the classics, working with the classics riders, and we're just getting ready for the E3 classic tomorrow, and then on Sunday it's the Ghent Verlegem, which is a great race. So I'd just like, as part of my introduction, just to share with you some of my background and some of the other things I'm involved with. And really, this is so that you can start to think about the types of questions, if you have questions, that you want to answer. And feel free to send in questions as we go along. And if Melissa thinks that there's something that we really want to answer now, then she'll interject and she'll say, here's a question for you, Nige, can you answer this? So part of my role, I also work for the English Institute of Sport as one of their technical leads. So this involves research and development around nutrition in professional sports, mentoring other nutritionists, and helping to support that structure. And for me, working at the level that I work at in sport, it's important that I maintain an academic interest. So I have a few university positions, of which one is at Portsmouth University and also the Liverpool John Moores University, where we've just actually started a PhD student looking into some of the nutrition, adaptation and training strategies that we use in cycling and how we can then understand it more. But part of my background is I'm a dietitian. I've worked as a dietitian for 20 years and I still maintain a clinical competency. So I still do some work as a clinical dietitian. So pulling all that together really helps me to support the athletes that we have in British Cycling and Team Sky to really achieve what they'd like to, the best that they can achieve. So this is the team that you've got here tonight. That's the picture at the top is myself. And then we've got Andy Kirkland from British Cycling. And at the bottom there, we've got Melissa. And one of the things I'd like to encourage you to do is to You can see some of the Twitter angles here. And the British Cycling Coaches Twitter and the Training Peaks angle is these are great areas of information for you. So if you if you're on Twitter and you follow these guys, then you get loads and loads of really, really good information. There's my Twitter angle there, but I don't do a lot of tweeting, maybe do 7 or 8 a year, but you're more than welcome to follow me if you want to. So what is it that we need to know? And when Andy asked me to do this session about nutrition for cycling coaches, I've got a lot of experience working with coaches, and coaches, in my experience, tend to be well-educated, well-trained, and have got a really good basic understanding of nutrition. But Andy wanted me to cover the basics so that people have got that, that foundation. So I'm going to cover that. I'm going to talk about what we mean by macronutrients, micronutrients, this concept of the balanced diet. But one of the things that I think becomes really interesting then for coaches and also athletes is when we look at events such as the Tour de France, is how do we use nutrition to help support perform the athletes in the Tour de France? And really using this as a metaphor about applied nutrition is then a way to encapsulate those areas around nutrition and actually that application. And hopefully there'll be some take-home messages for you guys listening. So understanding diet and nutrition. And if we really look at it, we can split it into these groups, I believe, the macronutrients, the micronutrients, and fluid. And I'll go into more detail with this as we go through. But when we're talking about the macronutrients, these are really where we're getting our energy. Macro meaning big, providing the nutrients that we need in large amounts. So this is proteins, fats, carbohydrates, and also alcohol. So these are the things that the body uses energy for. And we'll explore a bit more about actually what is the difference between them and what is the role. And very often in sport, we think about energy, we think about carbohydrate, we think about protein, but we don't always think about foods. So as a dietitian, I always work on a food-first approach. And as Andy said earlier, first met me up at Fort William, and part of my role there, I was actually cooking as well as doing the nutrition. And for me, this is really important, is to be able to understand about food. But I'm not a chef. But I do understand about food, and not being a chef and working with athletes is really useful, because then what I do is not perfect, it's real. And one of the things I've been doing today is I've been doing vegetable juices and for the riders and things like that. And that brings on to the micronutrients. So the micronutrients are really those nutrients that we need in small amounts. And when I'm working with the development athletes, younger athletes, the way that I talk about this is I say we have the go foods and the glow foods. So the go foods give the energy to make you go, and then the glow ones are actually make it all happen. They're the ones that give you the health and the vitality. And that's the micronutrients, so that's the vitamins and the minerals, essential fats, all these things are the things that actually bring it all together. And then the other part of the Venn diagram here is about fluid. And we all know how important fluid is, or we're told that we need to be well hydrated. But the way the body works is exchanging nutrients, exchanging electrolytes, and exchanging the waste from metabolism. And that's all done through fluid, and the body has got a constant turnover of fluid, just as it has with the energy as well. But we're constantly needing to take fluid, and fluid is so important for our body's function. And what a lot of people don't realise is the different compartments of fluid in our bodies. And that's not something that I'm really going to touch on tonight, but we have fluid within the blood, we've got fluid in the muscle, we've got fluid between the muscle and the blood, we've got fluid in the blood-brain, And when we're thinking about the whole fluid program with an athlete, then sometimes we have to consider everything. And when I'm working with either the Olympic or the Tour de France type athletes, this becomes a very important area to understand. Okay, so nutrition, we've got our food eaten, the macronutrients, the fat, the protein, the carbohydrate. So they're the things that are giving the energy. We've got our micronutrients, our vitamins, our minerals, our electrolytes, and that all comes into them, the work that the athlete can do. So it all combines together. And part of the concept really is that the nutrition fits in with training. And training, what we're looking at there, is trying to create an adaptation. So when an athlete trains, it provides a stimulus. And we're trying to look at either making the athlete stronger or fitter, more powerful. And the overload principle means that what we're trying to do is increase that stress on the system at each different session. And what this does is that stress means that the body has to change. And this is where the nutrients then really come in. Because all of these adaptations are really driven by changes in the protein synthesis or the buildup of protein. And so if we don't have the nutrients in the system, then we don't get the adaptation that we're looking for. If we haven't got the nutrients there, we will get an adaptation, but it's what we would consider a maladaptation or one that we're not looking for. And for a lot of experienced coaches here, they'll have experienced this, where they've worked with athletes and they've given them training and they haven't responded or adapted in the way they want, and they've actually gone backwards a little bit sometimes. And this is where that nutrition really fits in, because nutrition supports the training, that adaptation. And if we combine that together, if we get the training right, the nutrition right, then we tend to get the results that we're looking for. So let's talk a little bit about protein. And in a sport such as cycling, traditionally, the nutrients that people were particularly interested in was carbohydrate. It was all about carbohydrate for energy. And for us, carbohydrate is so important. I'm going to talk a little bit about some of the function there. But in sport, when we think about protein, then athletes and coaches often think about protein and they think about muscle. But actually, as far as the body's concerned, that's one of the lower priorities that it has for protein. It's used in so many things. So it's used for what we call colloidal pressure in the blood. So protein helps to maintain the pressure in the blood. The albumin is the protein, one of the proteins in the blood, helping to transport other substances, in other words. Enzymes are obviously critical for the metabolic pathways in the body. These are all using proteins. Formation of some of our hormones. So hormones are then chemical messengers that are released by areas in the body to try and communicate with another part in the body. Our immune system, as cyclists, we need to ensure that we've got a good functioning immune system. So again, it's a key component there. Also, it's an energy source. People don't think about protein and energy, but actually protein is a good contributor of energy. The body can convert protein into carbohydrate. And this is by a process called gluconeogenesis. And this is something where the body can use additional amino acids or, at times of trouble, use proteins and convert them into carbohydrate for the body. And it's important as well, again, just regarding the fluid balance. So loads of things there. So what about some of the things that people ask about it? Are some proteins better than others? Does eating more protein help me to get bigger? I always chuckle at that because people sometimes think that all you've got to do is eat a chicken breast or a big piece of salmon or whatever and you get bigger. And that's not the case. But so some proteins better than others. Then what we have is what we call the essential amino acids. So the essential amino acids are this group of amino acids that we can only get from our diets. in total, there's 22 amino acids, and we can convert one amino acid to another. But we've got a group that the body can't change, can't transfer. So we need to get them from the diet. So animal proteins, such as cheese or dairy, eggs, meat, chicken, fish, these tend to be higher in these essential amino acids. But actually, for people who are vegetarian, and I've worked with a lot of vegetarian and vegan athletes, we can actually get everything that we need from the vegetable source, or if somebody will take dairy as well, it makes it very easy. And one of the things that I may touch on again later when we're talking about the dairy source and we look at a lot of the protein products that are about at the moment, most of the quality protein products that people buy actually come from dairy protein. It's usually a whey protein. And in milk, that is made up of whey and casein. So the whey and casein is separated, and the whey can be used in protein products. Some products have casein in it. We are sponsored and work very closely with a company called CMP that provide the nutritional products, the protein products for both British Cycling and Team Sky. But they're all from this dairy source. And eating protein, does it make you bigger? No, it doesn't. What makes people gain muscle is the right type of exercise. And that is actually, again, that strength type of work. So it doesn't matter how much protein people eat, they won't just get bigger. However, if they don't eat enough, then that will affect the quality, the function of the muscle. So protein content of some foods, we can see that 20 grams of protein are in things like a small chicken breast, six fish fingers if you're eating them, cheddar cheese, pint of milk. And then the second class protein providing 10 grams of protein is things like 50 grams of peanuts, or about 40 grams of pistachio nuts if you were wanting to use pistachio nuts, baked beans, a few slices of bread, Weetabix. So we can see how we can start to combine proteins here to get the amounts that we need. What you'll also notice here is that with the vegetable sources is that these are not only providing some protein, these are also providing, these are our carbohydrate foods as well. So protein requirements for our riders. Factors that affect protein needs is the bigger is the body size. So the bigger you are, the more protein you need. And protein needs are about 1.5 grams per kilogram per day. And as again, as I'm a dietitian, I prefer to talk in foods, but this is to give you an idea of roughly per gram how much people need per stone. So this is, so a 70 kilo, roughly 11 stone rider would need about 112 grams of protein a day. So if you think of it just in milk, a pint of skim milk would give about 20 grams of protein. So that's roughly 5.5 pints worth of milk a day. Or again, we saw before, like a chicken breast is going to give, small chicken breast is going to give about 20 grams. So protein can easily be consumed from our diet. We can get this from the foods that we eat. Carbohydrates. So the function of carbohydrate in the body is to provide energy. What a lot of people do not realize is that our brain, our central governor, is dependent on carbohydrate, is dependent on glucose. So just bear with me a second. You've probably heard this sort of thing before. But what happens with carbohydrates? Let's say we eat a potato or some rice or quinoa or a carbohydrate-rich food. The carbohydrate in there is most likely in the form of starch. And starch are long compounds of glucose or other sugars. So it's a long, 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 long chain of it. We eat that, and as it's digested, each one of those individual sugar molecules, glucose molecules, are broken off, we absorb that, and that goes into the blood. As it goes into the blood, the fate of it is either for it to be converted and stored as glycogen in the liver. So the body's glycogen stores is really the same as a starch. So it's a long chain of it. So we may store it in the liver, or we may store some in the muscle, or it's used constantly as energy. But the thing with it is that the body's very good that if we're eating a lot more than we want, than what we need, or that it's going into the blood very quickly, then the body is very good at storing excess as body fat. And this is one of the things that we know now, that if we overeat carbohydrates, in particular the what we call the low glycemic, the ones that absorb very quickly, then we do end up storing more as fat. So we, always with elite athletes, it's getting the balance right of ensuring we're getting enough energy there so that they can train and compete and recover, but also helping to manage the body weight as well. And in the professional cycling scene, then people are always aware of that fine balance between ensuring the riders are super, super, super lean, but also fueled as well. So the function of carbohydrates, as I mentioned before, is really about providing energy. The brain is what we call a glucose-dependent tissue. So that means all it can use is carbohydrate. That's not quite true. It can also use ketones as well, and we don't often talk about ketones, that the ketones is something that the body will produce when it's starving, and it does this to protect the brain. So it's not something we normally use, but it is something that the body can use when we're really in a starved type of situation. So the brain alone will use approximately 100 grams of glucose a day. So in food terms, that's equivalent to maybe 5 small bananas or 5 small pieces of bread. And it's got this constant demand, this constant supply. And so carbohydrates obviously used when we're exercising, and the harder we exercise, the more carbohydrate we use. So it's the easiest form of energy for when we're doing hard cycling. Dietary sources mention some of these, where we have the sweet, sugary process, and we have the starchy, bread, potato, pie, rice, pasta, fruit. Big favourite of mine at the moment is things like quinoa. And again, just to show you a few examples, something like 3 Weetabix. So I apologise for people that are not from the UK if you don't get Weetabix, but in the UK we eat a lot of Weetabix. 3 of those gives about 50 grams of carbohydrate. I've said they're a large banana, but actually they're more like a medium banana. Thick slice of bread, large potato, and yes, something like a bag of Jelly Babies will give about 50 grams of carbs. I prefer athletes to be getting the carbohydrate from foods rather than sweets. So fats. Now, people don't always think about fats and exercise and sport, but actually fats are so, so important. And I just wanted to spend a few minutes talking about the essential fats. And we've got 2 essential fats. We've got alpha-linolenic acid, which is an omega-3 fat, and we've got linoleic acid, which is an omega-6 fat. So what these essential fats means is that, again, we can't make these from other fats. We have to get them in from our diet. And we get our fats from animal fats and vegetable fats. And you'll see a couple of pictures of fish, and the fish oils in particular, the omega-3 fats are great. And there's also a bottle there of the Team Sky olive oil, which is great at providing some of our really healthy essential fats as well. This slide is purely to show you that actually there's a lot of different fats. And these are just the range of the omega-3 fats. And the omega-3 fats just really refers to the structure of the fat, and the 3 just refers to the where a double bond is within that fat. And there's 2 in particular that we tend to be interested in sport. One is called EPA and one is called DHA. And EPA just stands for is the decosapentaenoic acid. And this is the one in particular that we're interested in sport, because this is one that we see can help a lot around the stress and managing the stress that we get within sport. DHA is really important around the brain and the nerves. And when we're looking at fish or fish oil products, the main 2 fats that they supply is the EPA and the DHA. And we can, again, get all of these from our diets, but very often today we don't have enough of these essential fats. So why is it that people supplement with omega-3s? Modern diet tends to be low in the omega-3s. 20% of the population actually say they regularly take fish. I also, that's part of the National Food Survey, so listening, so people who are on this webinar tonight, I would imagine that we've got a few hundred people who actually take fish oil supplements there, but maybe not know why they do it. And people believe that they're good for them, that they help to reduce aches and pains, help with rheumatoid conditions, improve cognition. And there's a growing increase in the use of fish oils in sport. And we've been using fish oils in sport now for about 10 years. And the reason we use it is to help to downregulate some of this stress of excessive exercise. So the first time we actually used fish oils in a big sort of race was used it with a couple of riders, GB riders who were riding on proteins in the 2003 Giro d'Italia. And what we aimed for there was them taking 2 grams of EPA a day. And again, we work with our current provider, CMP, to provide a really high quality fish oil product, which combines the EPA and some krill oil as well. So you combine those together, the krill oil have got some really good antioxidants in that help to protect that those fats and how it combines within the muscle. And sometimes when people do buy fish oils, they'll buy on price and they'll just buy the cheapest. And actually sometimes buying better quality products, you don't use as much. So the target we aim for is about 2 grams of the EPA a day. So what I want to do now, I've covered a background, and I want to go into some of the nutrition support, how we then apply this into the Tour de France and the Olympic Games. But before I do, I'll just ask Melissa, have we got any burning questions coming through yet, Melissa? Melissa?
I don't think, can you hear me, Nigel?
I can hear you, Andy.
I don't think Melissa's there. Can I just one question on the fish oils.
Yes.
Is there an alternative for vegetarians to...
Andy, that is a brilliant question. I'm glad that you asked that. Of course there is. So flaxseed is a great... So flaxseed is a really, really good source of the omega-3 fats as well. All of our seeds provide essential fats, but flaxseed in particular. But what people need to do when they take things like flaxseeds or any of the other seeds, they need to crush them up a little bit so your body can absorb the nutrients out of them. Otherwise, they just pass naturally out of the system.
Great, thanks, Nigel.
Okay.
Brilliant, thank you.
So I'm just going to talk a little bit then about nutrition and Tour de France and what we did at London Olympics. So a little bit about the service and support, a little bit about Sky and British Cycling, understanding the Tour de France, and a little bit about what we do. So nutrition support for Sky Pro Cycling, British Cycling, what we do is we want to create a nutritional performance environment. So it's the same philosophy for both organisations. So we want to try and ensure that riders know and make the right nutritional choices. So we try to develop a culture where they can see what other riders are doing and then take it on. And recently, I was working with one of the Team Pursuit's world champion riders from the women's squad. And she was saying, I was just going through her diet with her, and I'm asking about what she'd been doing, and she said actually that since she'd come to live with the other girls, then what she'd really been doing was seeing what their practice was, and that had changed her. So that really reassured me that we've got a system where people are actually being mentored and working with other people. So a big part of my job is looking at some specialist weight management, and that's really geared a lot at people think about like the Tour de France riders. But actually, when we're working with the any of the top riders, then we're wanting to get the right balance between power and weight. So when we look at the BMX riders, which are phenomenal athletes, what we're really trying to do there is maximise their strength and power, but minimise their body fats as well. Same with the sprinters. So it's really about getting that body weight right for them. I lead on things like fueling and hydration strategies. I look at designing and lead on the nutritional recovery plans. And again, that can go right from the Tour de France to when we were at the Olympic Games and on the team pursuit, we had to add a qualifier one night, semi-finals the next morning, and then with an hour, they had to perform again. And the GB squad was the only team that actually got faster. This were both for the men and women's that got faster at each successive round. So we've really done well to get that recovery there. There's a lot of innovation and research projects. As mentioned before, I have a food first policy, so about menu planning and looking at specialist food identification. One of the things that we've just started this year is we are using in Europe with the tour riders for us to control the delivery of the food, the meat. We're actually supplying meat from the UK for our red meat from a really good supplier in the south of England. So we're trying to control that, identify that, making it better. Work with our commercial partners such as CMP. Mentioned them already. So we're ensure that the products that we use are fit for purpose, quality assuring them. So it's important for us that there's no contaminants in there that might cause problems. So there's a lot of work around that side. When we look at the Tour de France, here's a picture of some of the early hydration and fueling strategies. And always makes me smile, this picture, because I'm sure that that's what a lot of the riders would still like. Since the early days, things have obviously moved on a little bit. But one of the things that these sort of pictures help to illustrate is that there's quite a range. And in the bottom left-hand picture here, this is a shot from inside the one of the race cars, one of the Jags. And what we've got here is a range of different gels and bars. We've got some gels with caffeine. We've got energy bars. We've got flapjack bars. And so if the rider is wanting anything, they can come back to the window, to the car, tell the coach what they want, the director sportif, and he'll pass it up. But for me, a great thing here is also it exemplifies that actually in cycling, this is different to a lot of sports, is that when we're on the road or the mountain bike, when we're training, that we can actually eat while we're training and racing. So we can take on fluid and take on food while we're still competing. And it's a team sport. So we can see the bottom right-hand picture. We've got Mark, who was the world champion then, and you know he's collecting bottles for the rest of the team. So he's a fantastic team player. Even though he was the world champion, he was taking his parts, he was getting the fluids and taking back. So there's a lot of things here that actually there's a lot of sophistication and we need to have systems in place. So elite sport and health, you know, getting the balance right. And there's a picture on the right-hand side there from my holiday in Disney a few years ago. And then on the other side is in the Team Sky training camp in Mallorca. And for me, understanding about a pathology where things are not going right helps me when I'm working with my athletes. And on the other end, working with the athletes also helps with that clinical side. So for me, it's a big continuum from super fit to super unfit. One of the things that one of the take-home messages for coaches is understanding the demands of the event. So what we do in British Cycling and in Team Sky, we spend a lot of time investing in trying to understand what is needed for the event. And this could be 30-second sprint, as in the Olympic Games, or it could be a 7-hour stage of the Tour de France, or like it was on Sunday, just short of 7 hours in Milan San Remo, where Ben Swift, congratulations to him, got third, which was a fantastic ride, and today's he's won in a race today, so that's great. So we spend a lot of time analysing the event and understanding the variables, and then we try to put everything into place. There's a lot of time invested in really understanding what's going on. We have a performance philosophy, which is about no compromise. And you know, this is where we have great interaction between our top athletes like Jason and our top coaches like Ian Dyer here. And so, but we target events. So we target the events that we can be the most successful in. And in the 2008 Beijing Olympics, British cycling became the most successful British Olympic squad of all time by getting eight gold medals. In 2012, it was felt that this really couldn't be repeated because some of the rules had changed. But actually, we managed to get 12 gold medals again. And the nice thing there, again, we've got Jason up there who got two gold medals. And we can see that actually, even though we got eight gold medals, the number of athletes who were involved in it is quite a small number. So we've got multiple gold medalists, such as Laura, such as Jason, and obviously Sir Chris Hoy. So the way that we work is that we have a performance problem. And again, this is thinking about things from a coaching or a nutrition point of view. We look at how we innovate. We look at then trying to validate that innovation, refine it, and it feeds back in and constantly evaluated and audited. So one of the things there was mentioned before about with the at the Olympic Games, the team pursuit, we had only 1 hour between the qualifier and then the final. How do we maximize recovery there? So Sky Pro Cycling, this was the brainchild of Sir Dave Brailsford. And for people who don't know, Dave is the performance director of British Cycling as well. And it was formed in 2009, and it was set up as a brand new team to start racing in 2010. And we've got roughly, I'm saying there, 30 riders. We've got 27 this year, about 45 members of staff. We've got doctors and that cover all of the race days. And the thing with Sky that's always been very, very, very clear is our zero tolerance to drugs. And all members, including staff, sign up that they've never been involved in doping. So everybody goes through an interview and signs up to that. And this is part of our core values. And really then this comes back to what our basic beliefs are, in that when I started working with British Cycling, we believed that we could be the top cycling nation in the world. And at that time, a lot of people said that actually you don't have this and you don't have that, it won't be achieved. But with the right dedication of the athletes and coaches and the support staff behind it, then that's something that British Cycling were able to achieve. With Sky Pro, with Team Sky, it was then really about looking at winning the Tour de France with a British rider. And again, people said you couldn't do this. But with that philosophy of great coaching, great support, such as the nutrition and the doctors and the psychology, again, they were able to achieve. So as people will be aware that, you know, the team managed to win the Tour de France at the third attempt. And in 2012, what an amazing year. We won the Tour de France, then it went into the Olympics. And in 2013, Chris Froome managed to win the Tour de France again. So our approach is really about excellence, minimizing underperformance. So the nutrition message there is really making sure that we're getting good, consistent practice. And very often, one of this is for me is an important message to the coaches. Very often, from a nutrition point of view, people will be thinking about some sort of whizzy supplement, some sort of nutritional product, but actually, have they got the basic diets right? So have the athletes you're working with got their basic diets right? Or if it's an athlete listening at the moment, have you got the basics right before looking at investing on some other type of strategy or raising? We always work within our rules and work with world-class partners such as the Jaguar, Pinarello, and CMP I've already mentioned. So part of the nutritional philosophy, it's part of the performance support team headed up by Tim Kerrison. It's really about focusing on quality, ensuring that riders are healthy and at the right weight. We don't want riders coming to big races and trying to lose weight. A very important thing for us is about gut health. And a lot of people don't think about the health of the gut, of the stomach. So I'm going to talk a little bit about that. How do we ensure that people have got good gut health? A lot of people will have had experience where they've been using bars, gels, drinks, and they get a bit of an upset stomach. And for when people are racing day after day after day, it's important that the stress on the stomach is minimized. Because if the stomach's not working properly, then we're not absorbing the nutrients that we need. So how does it work? We have training and nutrition together. Training provides the stimulus needed for that protein signaling pathways to drive adaptation. I touched on this earlier. And then the nutrition provides these basic blocks for the adaptation, the fluid, the proteins, the carbohydrates, the fats, the vitamins, minerals. So as I mentioned earlier, you need the two together. If you don't get the right nutrition, you won't get the right adaptation. If you don't train right, it doesn't matter what you eat, you won't get where you want to be either. And so when we're looking at things such as the Tour de France and we talk about recovery, then what does recovery really mean? And for us, recovery is we want the riders to be able to do their job, to be able to perform when they're required. And people often think in cycling that recovery is all about the fluids, all about the carbohydrates. But for me, that's the metabolic side, and that's quite easy. We've got the functional side about the muscle function, the protein synthesis, etc. Then that's more challenging. And then from a psychological, managing the pressure, etc. And all of these are interlinked and work together. You can't quite separate out exactly which is the highest priority. So Tour de France, why is it so important? This is just a slide from the 2013, and we all know that it's split into things like the flat stages, the hilly stages, mountain stages, time trials, rest days. Now, what a lot of people don't realize is that actually on a rest day, that if you've been riding 5-6 hours a day, then most people, if they have a rest day, all they want to do is put the feet up. But actually, on a rest day, the riders tend to do 2 to 3 hours on the bike. And actually, because they're not doing as much work on those days, then that's the day when they're quite careful with what they eat so that they don't put too much weight on either. So people might think that, oh, on a rest day, that's an opportunity to do nothing and just eat. Well, actually, the riders still do some exercise, not as much, obviously, but they're also quite careful on what they eat as well. So there's no such thing, really, as a rest day. Why they're so special? This picture was taken just 2 weeks before the start of the Tour de France in the Pyrenees. We were trying to get some warm weather acclimatization type training in the Pyrenees, and it rained all the time, and I think it didn't get warm. It wasn't any warmer than about 4 or 5 degrees. So this is why they tend to be so special, is because the weather can be so unpredictable. Mentioned before about gut health, and we've got a little picture of the digestive system, and we can see that really when we think about the digestive system, that this is really a tube that goes from top to bottom, or mouth to anus. And it's designed to hold food, as in the stomach as a reservoir, and that will release food on a controlled basis into the small intestine, where it's digested fully and absorbed. And then through that process, we then get the waste, where more water is extracted, and then obviously we get rid of that waste. But it's quite a sensitive organ, is the digestive system. And again, putting it in simple terms, what we have here is the body will eat something like a full protein, like chicken. It's broken down into the base amino acids, absorbed, and then it's built back up. So we have to really take care of this. And some common gastrointestinal issues can be bloating, diarrhea, cramping, or gastroenteritis. And we want to try and avoid these because they'll affect the function of the gut. Up on the top right there, there's just a magnified picture of what we call the villi, which is in the small intestine. And this just increases the surface area so that we can absorb all of the nutrients. Bike riders are vulnerable to gut issues. And really, this is because that the situation they're in, where we're getting things flicked up off the road onto the bidons and we can drink them, but also exercising in the heat reduces the microvilli viability. Low pH affects it as well. So if we're drinking gallons and gallons and gallons of sports drink, which traditionally has a low pH, then that can affect as well. So we have to think about drinks that we're having. Not everybody, but some people are sensitive. Exercise reduces the splenic blood flow. So what that means is the blood flow to the stomach. The riders we've mentioned are in this hostile environment, and contaminants can reflect out, causing problems. So within Team Sky, what we do, and also British Cycling, it's the same philosophy, then what we do is that we, because we use a lot of sports drinks, then we've developed a neutral pH sports drink. So it's got a pH of 7, instead of regular sports drinks having a pH of between 3.5 and 5.5. We've also developed much more stomach-friendly gels. So we have a gel that's based on a juice concept, which is, again, much easier on the stomach. And we do a lot of alkalizing foods, so we do a lot of vegetable juice. I mentioned, I think earlier, that I've been doing vegetable juice for the riders. So what this does, it just helps to balance out that acidity in the gut. But also when we do juice, what it means is that the riders can get the nutrition without necessarily eating all of the volume that we might get from just eating, you know, when we're just having all the vegetables. We've developed rice cakes, which is like a solid rice pudding. And again, within the protein products we've used, these we have a glutamine. The fish oils are great, the olive oil. So food is the cornerstone. I've mentioned before that we've got some world-class products, supports the overall food strategy, but food is key. And there's a picture there of one of the dishes that Soren, our head chef, has created. Fuel and hydration, we want to prevent underperformance due to poor fueling, poor hydration, supplying appropriate foods based on needs, try and conserve muscle glycogen stores as long as possible, maintain even glucose levels. We don't want them spiking up and down, and we want not wanting to lose or gain energy. So fueling strategies for the guys when they're doing the big day, the big stages, will be to consume between 60 and 90 grams of carbohydrate per hour. And we use a modular system where roughly everything supplies about 20 grams of carbohydrate. So a gel is 24 grams, roughly, say, once the problem they don't get it all out, so it supply about 20 grams. Half an energy bar or a flapjack bar, piece of the rice cake, if they're having a little panini, or a bottle of the race drink. All of these are providing approximately the same amount of carbohydrates. In the earlier part of the races, then the riders will have more solids, and then as the race gets faster or we're going up big hills, then we'll start to use more gels to get the energy. Oh, going the wrong way, sorry. We have what we call a positive hydration strategy, and what this really means is that we really encourage the riders to drink without them thinking about it. So we monitor their fluid, where we're looking at change in their body weights and urine concentration. But what we're trying to do there is really encourage the riders to drink on a regular basis, so they're not having to think too much about it. And this is part of it, where we're actually not just supplying the fluid in the form of drinks, we also do it in food. So we've got a picture just below there of the rice cakes before they're cooked up. So this is again like a solid rice pudding, which provides fluid as well as the energy. And at the bottom is some of the vegetable juices. So we've got one with, looks like some beetroot, and the other one looks like some celery and pear to me. So look, going through it, when the weather's really hot, the riders will drink up to a litre an hour, which will be 1 litre of the race drink. A bottle of the race drink and a bottle of water. After the finish, they're given a recovery drink, which is a protein drink, which again, that will give the protein plus fluid. We use hydration drinks, which is basically a diluted juice. Things like rice, potatoes, all of these are really high in fluid, as well as providing the food as well. So I've mentioned before, we monitor some of the weights with the guys. And this is just a typical day's food that they may have on a road stage, or sorry, the foods that are available to them. So you just see that there's opportunity for them to be eating on a real regular basis. So this would be just like a typical plan on a normal road stage for a rider. This might be on a time trial stage. You notice as a breakfast, we might have something like omelette and rice, pre-race meal. The standard thing that we'll tend to do would be just omelette and rice. This is the typical sort of daily intake that riders may have. Again, some pictures of Sorin's food, which are always beautiful, where they may be having 500 to 600 grams of carbohydrates. You'll notice that the protein intake that they have is higher than what I mentioned as a basic requirement before. The reason for this is because there is so much protein availability for the riders. And just to finish with that, this year is a really special year that the Tour de France is coming to Yorkshire. I never believed that I'd see the Tour de France coming to my home county, so it's something that I'm really excited about to be part of. Team Sky and also the Tour de France coming to Yorkshire. So I'm going to wrap this presentation up here, which just leaves us a little bit of time for a few questions. Andy?
Thanks, Nigel. I'll put you over to Melissa in a second. Just for everyone listening, I would say Nigel's mentioned vegetable juices, cooking and whatever, and there's some really great videos on YouTube of Nigel with, is it Soren, the Team Sky chef?
Which, oh, that's correct. Yeah, I don't know how people find them, Andy, but Soren.
Just a search on YouTube, Nigel. So well worth a look to see them. It's something I do and encourage other people to do, so to look at these videos, because they're well worth a look.
I think Soren does a really, really good job on those videos. He shows how to cook steak. A lot of people don't cook meat as well as they should. And he also does a really good porridge as well on those videos.
Right. I've got one question for you, Nigel, which I think is very, very pertinent to our coaches. Now, the majority of the coaches we work with at British Cycling aren't at the top end. They're working more with developmental riders, so from the age of 13 to 18.
Yeah.
Could you give us some insight to what sort of programs you do with, say, Olympic development riders within that age group to develop a healthy diet with riders that maybe coaches could apply with the riders they work with?
Again, I mean, that's an excellent question, Andy, because, you know, really the young developing riders, this is our future. And part of the work that I love the most is working with the British Academy riders, and I love taking some of these guys, and I remember some of the guys have come along and they've never even chopped an onion before, and you know, helping to, you know, the knowledge they can have can be quite good, but the practical skills are sometimes not so good. So I think one of the things I'd be saying to the coaches who are working with some of these young riders, and it depends on the age and facilities, etc., we're actually trying to get people looking at some practical things where people can take more ownership for themselves, and being able to arrange practical workshops around diet and nutrition. Part of my clinical work now I do is, when I work with people, is I realise that a lot of people have got quite a good understanding of what a healthy diet is, that they then struggle to put that into practice. And also for young people, we've got to remember that there can be a constant conflict for them, because not only are they wanting to be trained athletes, but they're also young people and wanting to be going out with their friends as well. So we've got to get this balance right. So actually, when we look at this concept of a balanced or a healthy diet, then there can be some room for an occasional takeaway. It's really when that occasional takeaway becomes the habitual diet. So if somebody was to go out with their friends maybe once or twice a week and have you know, a takeaway type meal or a fast food type meal, that's not a massive issue. However, it's when they're doing that every day that it really undermines what they're trying to do as an athlete. And I think that's an important thing for the coaches to realise, is that you know, once or twice a week isn't going to be the end of the world. But every day, that's when they need to be addressing it. And what you probably find is that if you've got somebody who isn't that committed to what they're doing food-wise, then they're not going to be that committed to the overall training program as well. Does that answer that question, Andy?
That's a brilliant answer, Nigel. Thanks. Now, over to Melissa in Colorado. Questions that you've had, Melissa?
Thanks, Andy. Thanks, Nigel. Well, we have been super busy collecting questions. So before I give one to Nigel to answer, I just want to remind people that we are going to take the questions and go through all of them and compile a list of the more popular ones, and we'll put together some type of blog article or some type of resource article so that if your questions are not answered in the next 2 minutes that we have, you'll be able to get some great information out of this article that we'll put out on our blog, and we'll work with British Cycling on that. So one of the questions that we had over and over again is, what do you think about multivitamins?
Okay, so what we're talking about there is using multivitamins. What you're saying there is as a supplement. So for me, this is quite an easy one. If we've got a diet where we're getting regular fruit, vegetables, I mentioned before about the micronutrients. So if we've got a diet that's quite a complete diet, then there's not an issue. And nature is absolutely fantastic. That if we eat whole foods, then it provides the carbohydrate, but it also provides the vitamins that we need to metabolize it. So the best example is oatmeal bread. So wholemeal bread provides carbohydrate, but also within that wholemeal part of it is the B vitamins, the thiamine, that the body requires to metabolize the carbohydrate from that food. Now, what people say is that, right, I'm an athlete, so therefore I'm doing more work, so I need more vitamins, which is true, but we are actually eating more foods. So if we're eating more foods that are providing those vitamins, then actually we can get it from our diet. Now then, big part of it comes back to then is how good is our gut health. So if we're eating a diet and we're getting, and it's a diet that's rich in the foods that provide the vitamins and the minerals, tomatoes, apples, oranges, bananas, things like this, so we're getting it all. But if our gut health isn't great, then again we might not be absorbing all of those nutrients that we need. A lot of people feel a lot of benefit by taking a multivitamin type product. And I've got no issues if people want to take a multivitamin product. But the ones that I would recommend are the ones that supply approximately 100% of the daily recommended values, the RDAs or the DRVs, whichever system we're using, and not ones where they're supplying 10 times that amount. And one of the reasons is that then that starts to put the body out of kilter. So within British Cycling and Team Sky, we do use a multivitamin, multi-mineral product, which is supplied again by our sponsor CMP. But it's not something that I over-encourage, because what I want to do is to get all the goodness that the athletes need from the diet. I hope that helps people listening.
All right, thanks. So we've got one more question. Okay. What is your best practice for caffeine intake for a one-day race?
Okay, so from a caffeine point of view, I mean, this is we could do a seminar just on caffeine here, Melissa. Caffeine has got so many multi-functional aspects on the body. It's just so many different things. From a performance point of view, then I personally believe that there can be a tendency to overdose a little bit on caffeine for a lot of people. And what we tend to do is use caffeine really quite conservatively. So we'll use it in two respects, and we don't do it in like an aggressive type of strategy. We're quite subtle with it. So riders before a race will tend to have two or three coffees, maybe even three or four, which may supply between 100 and a couple hundred milligrams of caffeine, which is about enough for most people to start to get the systems working, helping with some of the some of the release of some of the body parts into the system, helping with some of the calcium ion exchange, helping with a cognitive point of view. And then during the race, then riders might use one or two caffeine gels. And the caffeine gels are really about giving some quick-acting carbohydrate, but also the caffeine has an effect on the central nervous system to give a little bit of a boost there. And we'll also use just a normal caffeine gel, which supplies about 100 milligrams of caffeine as part of our time trial type warm-up. So I have used it, and I've got experience of people going really, really sort of strict and on larger amounts of caffeine, but I've never found it more beneficial than just being a little bit more subtle with it. And one of the downsides can be that if we have too much caffeine later on in the day, let's say we're doing something like an Omnium event on the track, then it can affect people's sleeping as well. So we have to be a little bit careful, because we want people to sleep and recover for the next day.
Yeah, Nigel, this is Dirk Friel, actually.
How are you doing?
I'm doing really good. Thanks so much for participating in this. This is wonderful. Definitely had the honor of meeting you in Mallorca at a Team Sky Camp. I'll see you in UK for the start of the Tour de France, for sure.
Oh, that'll be fantastic, Dirk.
Yes, and I've met Andy last September at Training Peaks University. That was a great event that you guys hosted for us, and who knows, maybe we can do more of those in the future. And I just wanted to chime in and say thanks to everybody for attending. This has been wonderful.
Okay, that's great. Well,
many thanks, Dirk.
Cheers.
Well, and just to wrap things up, we are recording this, and we will make the slides available if you're interested in having a copy. I know there was a lot of information in there in Nigel's presentation. So we will be sending an email out in 1 or 2 days with all that information, the link to the recorded webinar, and information on how to get the slides. And keep your eyes open for future webinars that we'll be doing together with British Cycling. So thank you, everyone, for taking the time out of your day and attending today.
And thanks from me, Andy Kirkland at British Cycling, and to Nigel for giving his time up at a really, really busy time for Nigel, who's over to support the guys in Belgium just now. So thanks once again, Nigel.
Cheers, Andy. Speak to you all soon.